If you fly on a regular basis, you know that there are many reasons that a flight can be delayed. Overbooking, bad weather, mechanical issues are common culprits. But the passengers of an American Eagle flight departing from New York City to Washington experienced a four-hour delay due to something a bit unexpected, a shouting match between flight attendants. What triggered the altercation? While instructing passengers to turn off all electronics, including cell phones, the attendant noticed an attendant in the back speaking on her cell phone, and that did it. "Every cell phone must be turned off right now," she said in a terse voice, including the attendant in the back. And that attendant yelled back at her, and before they knew it, they were embroiled in a shouting match. Got so bad that the cockpit was alerted and the plane had to turn back to the gate. "I find it hard to believe," writes one frustrated passenger, "the flight attendants could not work together for such a short period of time." Even though those airline employees knew that everyone was watching, even though they knew that that intensity could jeopardize the safety of the passengers and certainly jeopardize the future of their careers, they just couldn't, or they just wouldn't, stop themselves. They were too worked up emotionally to think rationally. Ever been there? If you say no, you're a liar. And Revelation 21 says all liars have their place in the lake of fire that never burns. So just keep that in mind, okay? Former heavyweight boxer Mike Tyson said, "Everyone has a plan until he gets hit in the face." And then that changes things just a little bit. And then reason goes out the window and rage takes over. Now, every one of us seated here today or standing have either been a transmitter or a receiver of rage. We know what the intensity feels like. And in those miserable moments, those nasty times, what we really need is a person with a warm heart and a cool head, right, to help pull down the crisis that lies before us. Weeks ago, we examined Chapter 4, the book of Philippians. And Paul asked the pastor of the church to come alongside a couple of ladies, remember them, Yodi and Syntyche, to cool their jets. He was persuading them to ease the tension and the turmoil that was existent in that wonderful Philippian church. Today, in our second message in the life of Abraham in chapter 13, tension will erupt between tent dwellers. One man steps in to cool the jets. He's our man of the hour, Abram. Now, you recall last week in our first message, Abram stepped out in faith, in a radical step to follow God's lead to a foreign and certainly a foreboding country. Things looked great until he slipped into fear. He saw a famine on the horizon, so he exits Canaan without advice from God and enters Egypt, and that's when everything began to go downhill. In the weeks to come, we will see of the crisis that threatens the world peace today, and we will examine it in great detail based on what Abraham did with somebody he picked up in Egypt. In Egypt, he made a big mistake. He lied about his wife, almost lost his bride. He walked out, as we discovered last week, feeling like a basset hound looks. Life was not too good for Abraham, but the wonderful thing about people of faith, as he took the next step, he not only slipped into fear, but in chapter 13, he started looking fine. He returns back to Bethel, the house of Elohim, the Almighty, and he built an altar, and he began to worship God and walk with him again. And at the altar, And we mentioned that this is our altar. This is the place where we meet God on a regular basis. At the altar, he found forgiveness. He found refreshment. He found the ability and strength to start again and take a step in a new life. And that's where chapter 13 brings us to today, a renewed Abraham after the fall. He's a changed man. And here we see the secret for Abraham's success and for our success. Every one of us this morning has failed a multiplicity of times. But when we come to God and receive his grace and forgiveness, it changes our lives. And something happens to our hearts. We can't hold that love inside anymore. We got to give it. We got to share it. We got to spread it to others. And that's exactly where Abraham's at today. He's the man who's going to cool the jets, and he's going to calm the crisis before us. He starts with the magnanimous offer we're going to see in just a moment that occurs in the midst of conflict. Now, as we step into chapter 13, the first thought we see is this, and that is the shepherd's strife. Verses 5 and 6. We examined verses 1 to 4 last Sunday. Now Lot, that's Abram's nephew, who went with Abraham, also had flocks and herds and tents. And the land could not sustain them while dwelling together, for their possessions were just too great, they were not able to remain together. Verse 2 told us Abram was very rich in livestock, silver and gold, the man with the Midas touch. Abram was a wealthy shepherd. He had done well as a businessman back in the Ur of the Chaldees for the first 65 years of his life. Then he goes to Egypt, and last week he acquired more wealth. Lot picked up wealth as well and numerous shepherds. This wealth did not cause strife between an uncle and a nephew, but it did cause tension between the shepherds. The herdsmen are hassling each other. Now, in the past few years, we have found a brand new way to create friction, tension, aggravation between family members, friends, and people in a church fellowship. What's this wonderful gift that we've been given? Social media. Yes. And there's a new thing on social media. Experts call it flaming. Flaming is used to describe emails, text messages, tweets, Twitters, foolish words sent out by angry people. I've been the victim of some of those. Perhaps you have as well. People just saying things. And here's what I don't understand about this whole thing of our modern age. This is what really gets me about this communication through email today and tweets and text messages. I understand it when a person is aggravated and they blew up, say something off the cuff, right, without thinking about it. But when you have to take your fingers and punch in these tiny, minuscule little letters, you are thinking about what you are saying. No longer is this an accident. This is a precedent. This is what frightens me about the tension that I see today in flaming. Flaming comes across with in large capital letters for years. I'm not much of a typist, and so I did not want to type the little letters. I would just type the big ones, and people thought I was yelling at them. I wasn't. I was just using the big letters, but now I discovered it meant that I go to the smaller ones. But people use all the big letters, and they use just the whole assortment of exclamation points and questions, and they put out, you know, things like this, you know, do you know what I'm talking about? Flaming. I'll tell you, if cell phones were available in Abraham's day, they would have been flaming across the fields. Things would have been set on fire with aggravation and tension. Now, we know, we wish it weren't true, that tension is very common in close relationships. It happens in a home, and it happens in a place where you're employed. The reason for this tension, most likely, as the scripture has stated, is that the territory was too tight. Things were too confined. It's like the line from the old cowboy film. this town ain't big enough for the both of us, right? Someone's got to go. It's exactly what we have going on here. And look at the end of verse 7. Now the Canaanite, well, look at verse 7, the beginning part of it, says that there was strife between the shepherds of Abram's livestock, the herdsmen of Lot's livestock, but the Canaanite and the Perizzite were dwelling in the land. You say, why is that mentioned? Because last week, Abraham left Egypt blowing his testimony. Remember? Pharaoh said, you lied to me about your wife. Get lost. Abraham feels about this big. Now that he sees the tension, he is sensitized to unbelievers, to the Canaanites and the Perizzites, and he is concerned with what they're thinking. Christian, are you concerned with what others are thinking about you? I'm not talking about being a people pleaser. I'm talking about the right type of sensitivity that your neighbors and your friends and your family members are watching your behavior and are watching the words that you speak. Abraham is a new man now. He is sensitized as a result of last week's mistake, and so this is going to help him be more tender in his treatment with Lot and the shepherds. Remember what Paul told us in Philippians 2 months ago? Let's refresh our memories in regards to our witness to the world. Read this with me. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, so that you will prove yourselves to be blameless and innocent. Now watch this. Children of God, above reproach, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you appear as lights in the world. We can't expect the world to have lights. Don't get angry and upset and bent out of shape with the world and the foolish things that you hear on the news. They're the world. They're crooked. They're perverse. They don't know any better. They don't have the light. You've got the light. You share the truth. You reveal the love. And that's how Abraham is going to act in this section. Abraham wants the strife to cease, so that brings us to our second point, and here it is. The shepherd's strife leads to the sensitive solution. Abraham said to Lot, verse 8, please let there be no strife between you and me, nor between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we are brothers. Pastor Adrian Rogers said, there are no problems too big to be solved. Only people too small to solve them. The herdsmen and the airline stewardesses, too small. Abraham, larger than life. He has the right attitude. Lot, we're brothers. Not only relatives, we're brothers in the faith. We both know the Lord. We don't want to be bickering. Don't be fighting with people in your church. Don't be arguing with people in the ministry. If there's tension existing between you and another person in this church today, before you get in your car, get with them, put your arms around them, love them, pray with them, make it right. That's the will of God for your life and mine. He doesn't want us to be bickering or tense with others. It's a bad testimony. I read about two Christian women who worked in an office some years ago who had a terrible testimony. They bickered all the time. One would say about the window, I feel like I'm going to suffocate in here. Would someone open the window and bring me fresh air? And the other lady would say, if that window is kept open, I will catch my death of cold. Close it. Back and forth they went. A non-Christian who worked there had a great solution. He said, here's my idea. Why don't you keep the window closed until one of you dies of suffocation? Then we'll open it up. The other could die of pneumonia. We'll have peace. There's a godly solution. Abraham said, the eyes of the world are on us. Let's not fight. I love Abraham. He's such a great heart. Look at this line, verse 9. It's so good. Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. If you go to the right, I'll take the left. You see what he's saying? He says, Lot, take whatever you want. Has your heart ever been so magnanimous that you've been able to make that statement to someone? Take whatever you want. Just give, right? That's the heart of love. Nobleman once complained to St. Francis of Assisi. St. Francis, a thief just stole my boots. He said, quick, run after him. Give him your socks as well. Lot said, take my boots, take my socks, take anything you want. I could live with less. You know, he's the older man, Abraham. He's the leader of the clan. He had all rights to top priority. Nowhere in the book of Genesis do we read of the Lot covenant. Anyway, there's an Abrahamic covenant. God gave the land to Abraham, not to Lot. But since God gave to Abraham, Abraham could give to Lot. If God gives money to you, you could give a portion of that back to him on Sunday. You could trust him. He will be good to you. We're going to see that in our text today. You're good to others, God will be good to you. Don't be stingy with your love, with your money, with your time. Give it out. God will always bring it back to you. There are times in the ministry when things get so tight and so tough. Sometimes things go smoothly, and then all of a sudden I got a million things to do in a short period of time. And I say, Lord, how am I going to get through this? I don't know how, I can't get it all done. And he just says, if you just do it, I'll give you the time. And he stretches it out, and people cancel appointments and give me more time. It's wonderful. God's always gracious, but he checks my heart to see if I'm willing to give. And that's what he's doing with Abraham. And Abraham says, I will give to you, Lot. I will give to you. He's gracious. He put the needs of others above his own. General William Booth, who was the founder of the Salvation Army, was too ill to attend the Army's World Conference one year. And so he sent the delegates a message by cable. And the message was only one word. Others. That was the word of his life. Did we discover that the theme of the book of Philippians was J-O-Y? Remember how we spelled joy? Jesus first, others second, yourself last. If you live by that formula, you will eliminate all tension between your spouse and your children. There'll be no aggravations in the workplace or amongst friends or in the fellowship. If Jesus is first and others are second. Abraham lived by that principle thousands of years before it was penned and thousands of years before General Booth was born. Now, he didn't practice it at the end of chapter 12, did he? He was a little bit selfish, wasn't he? He said, you know, they may take my wife and my life, but if I tell them they're my sister, they may give me some money for my honey. So here's Sarah, you can have her. So he was thinking me first. That was last week. If you missed it, you should have been here. Yeah. It's great. But now, he's not operating like that anymore. He said, I'm giving it all. His heart and life has changed. Wow. He'd learned his lesson of putting others before himself. You know why? Because we discovered last week that the symbol of his life was the tent. Remember that? What does the tent say? Temporary. I could pick up stakes. I could move on. I'm not firm. Whenever God calls me, I will move with him. He was not hooked into his possessions. He was ready to move at a moment's notice. The symbol of his life was the tent because the secret of his life was the altar. That's where he worshiped God. It seems like everywhere he went, he built an altar, he built an altar, he built an altar, he built an altar. He was always concerned about worshiping God and walking with God. And when that's your heart, the world will see it by your desire to give. Because you're going to say, it's not mine anyway. In fact, just the opposite. It's all mine anyway. So I could give it out and it'll come back to me. Because he knew where his focus was at. Over 150 years ago, the old Scot, Alexander McLaren, put it well. Listen to this. it does not matter much what accommodations we have on shipboard when we know the voyage is so short. If our thoughts are stretching over the sea to the landing at home and the welcome there, we shall not fight with our fellow passengers about our cabins or our places at the table, because we're going home. And the Bible says about Abraham in Hebrews 11:9, by faith, Abraham lived as an alien in the land of promise. It's his land, but he lives as an alien there. He's looking for the city whose architect and builder is God. Are you looking for that city today? Don't get your stakes down too deep here. This stuff is going to go up in smoke. Read the book of Revelation. It's all going to burn. Read 2 Peter. All the elements will be destroyed. Everything, not only on this planet, the entire universe. I hear people say this quite often. I heard it on the movie the other night. Well, the universe has been good to us. The universe has been good to us. That's how unsaved people see it. The universe is going to be gone. Then who's going to be good to you? God's going to destroy all the universe and create a new universe. Read that in Revelation. So don't get hooked in down here. And even if it doesn't burn up, in the next 5 minutes, you could have a cardiac arrest and drop dead. You need to have your home focused in heaven. And if that's your focus, you could give that on earth. It's not going to bother you. Abraham was willing to give. That's why he makes such a magnanimous proposal. Unfortunately, the sensitive solution gives birth to the selfish selection. The selfish selection pops up now, verses 10 and 11. Watch verse 10, how it sets it up. It's wonderful. Lot lifted up his eyes. He saw all the valley of the Jordan, well watered everywhere. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. It was like the Garden of the Lord. It was like Eden, like the land of Egypt as you go down to Zoar. And Lot chose for himself all the valley of the Jordan, and Lot journeyed eastward. It was a wrong move to make. Abraham said, choose whatever you want. As the younger, Eastern etiquette said you defer to the older. No, no, Uncle Abraham, you choose first. Had Lot said that, he would have saved himself the devastation, which we're going to look at in the weeks to come, of Sodom and Gomorrah. Unbelievable. The choices you and I make in our lives every day alter our lives for time and eternity. Be careful with those choices. Lot's making a choice by vision. He lifted up his eyes. He liked what he saw. He made his choice on the basis of looks. There was a man named Sylvester who grew up in the South during the Great Depression. He met Barbara on a blind date. He didn't know quite what she looked like, or she didn't know quite what he liked, but they were given information about each other. And Barbara was told that Sylvester was a good-looking guy, and he was handsome and athletic. In fact, his son played in the major leagues for many years. The doorbell rang, and Barbara went to the door, and she saw a man and was surprised. He didn't look like she thought he would be looking. He was woefully out of shape, did not take care of his body, obviously. He looked nothing like the athletic young man that she'd been warned about. So she stood there for a moment, surprised. And then all of a sudden, another guy jumped out from behind him and said, I'm Sylvester, go with me. She was wondering what was going on. Turns out Sylvester asked the other guy to come along, because he had never seen Barbara before. And in case she was ugly, she could go out with him. But because she was pretty, I'm Sylvester, go out with me. They were married for 60 years. Sylvester selected Barbara on the basis of looks, and it turned out well. Abraham or Lot chose Sodom on the basis of looks, and it turned out to be hell. We're going to see the trouble in 2 weeks that he'll get into in chapter 14, just living down there. And then chapter 19, everything goes downhill. Lot lifted up his eyes. I guess there's nothing wrong with looking at things, per se. But we have to be careful with our eyes, don't we? Every man who sits in here today, women have a greater character than men. That's why you find pretty girls with guys that don't look so good, because they're concerned with character. They're deeper. They want to know who you are. Men don't care about who you are. They want to know what you look like. And so because of that, we men have to be careful with our eyes. Because give us just a few seconds, and we'll start scanning and undressing and imagining. And the Bible says you be careful with those eyes. And maybe women need to be careful when it comes to shopping malls. I don't know. I'm not a woman. But everyone has a weakness when it comes to the eyesight and what we're drawn to. One commentator writes well, Lot's eyes were the binoculars of his heart. Good, huh? The greed that was there sucked in the view of the well-watered plain, and he made the fatal choice. It's the circumstance, I like this, it's the circumstance that reveals what a man truly is. Circumstances don't make or mar a man any more than a storm fells a tree. The rot in the heart of the tree or the shallow root system is revealed by the storm. The flaw's always been there, waiting for the first wind to reveal it to the eyes of the world. Lot lifted up his eyes, saw the valley of Jordan, well watered, and he liked it. He saw the swaying palm trees. He saw the green foliage. He saw the hill country where he's standing, and the beauty over there. And he said, that's what I want. I'm going to the nice country. Before God set that place aflame, you could go there today, you won't find the nice country in Sodom and Gomorrah. You'd be shocked to see the desolate section of that land. Verse 10 implies, Sodom reminded Lot of a place called Egypt. You know, it's interesting, in Egypt, last week, Abraham wound up embarrassed. Not Lot. Lot enjoyed Egypt. Lot's where he got his first taste for the gold and the silver and the wealth. And now he wants. So he moves his tents in the direction of the wealth. Wisely, they separate to end the strife between the shepherds. It says at the end of verse 11, they separated from each other. Sometimes, and we've seen this in relationships, separation is a necessary solution, even in a marriage for a while. I read about a man and his wife who appeared to be happily married for 55 years, and someone asked, what's the secret for your marital bliss? He said, well, it all goes back to our honeymoon. My wife and I had this agreement, and it went like this. If she was really irritated about something, she'd just tell me and get it off her chest. And if I was bothered by something she was doing, I was to take a long walk. I guess you said my marital bliss could be attributed to the fact that I've largely led an outdoor life. Abraham and Lot are living outdoor lives. You go one way, we go the other way, and we'll end all the tension between the shepherds. You know, this was Abraham's best decision, you're going to see in a moment, and it was Lot's worst decision. Isn't that interesting? One moment in time changed the destiny of two men. Your destiny and the world's destiny could be changed in an instant by the decision that you make when an opportunity is offered to you. Do you choose it on the basis of what God wants or the basis of what you want with a pocketbook? Lot never asked the question when he looked at Sodom. Oh, man, is this a good place to raise children? His question was, is this a good place to raise cattle and get rich? You know what we're going to discover when we get to chapter 19? His daughters were worse than cattle. It'll almost make you cry to see what they do with their dad. Don't read ahead. Little did Lot know that the physical beauty for that area was a small compensation for the catastrophic calamity yet to come. But Abraham made a good decision, didn't he? And from this point on, Abraham's going up, up, up. Lot's going down, down, down. He was a believer. 2 Peter tells us he was. He loved the Lord. You'll see him in heaven. But he made bad choices as a believer. You could do that and still be a Christian, you know. Verses 12 and 13. So Abraham settled in the land of Canaan, while Lot settled in the cities of the valley, moving his tents now as far as Sodom. Now the men of Sodom were not just wicked, but they were exceedingly wicked and sinners against the Lord. He knew that, but he didn't care. Hear Christians say that. I know I shouldn't be hanging around with this unsaved person. I know I shouldn't be dating a person who doesn't love the Lord, but it's going to be okay. It won't be okay. It's okay to hang around this bar. It's okay to pick up this chick. It's okay. It's okay. And it may look okay, and you may think you're strong enough. You're not. Like Lot, you'll fall, won't you? I like the way John Phillips put it. Listen to this. This is great. The first question that comes to a soul is heaven or hell? The second question that comes to a soul is heaven or earth? Heaven or earth? Lot made the right decision when he left Mesopotamia. He was saved. He made the wrong decision when he moved to Sodom. He was carnal. He chose earth over heaven. And so Abraham is watching. He knows that Lot made a poor decision, but he also knows in his heart he was gracious. And so God sees that, and guess what? When he sees what you're doing, he steps in to reward you. Isn't that great? Those little kind things that you do don't go unnoticed by him. That's our fourth point. See it here. The sovereign speaks. The sovereign speaks. Verse 14. The Lord said to Abram after Lot separated from him. Lot leaves. Abraham's left alone. And God goes, you're not alone. And you're not without wealth. I'm going to bless the socks off you. You've been good to Lot. I'm going to be good to you. It's exactly the principle under which God operates. First of all, we notice as the sovereign speaks, he speaks to them about his land. Verses 14 to 15. Now, God said, lift up your eyes. Interesting. Lot lifted up his eyes in verse 10 with a look of greed. Abraham has a good look. Now you lift up your eyes, God said. Look from the place where you are, north, south, east, and west. Abraham, you know that piece of property that you just gave Lot? He's not going to want it in a few years. You may not want it, but it's yours. Look everywhere you can see in a circle, north, south, east, west, as far as your vision will take you. It is your land. So start singing it. This land is my land, this land is my land. It's not your land, it's my land. He could have sang that, but he didn't. It's all yours. It's all yours, Abram. Look at verse 17. Scoot down to verse 17. Arise, walk through the land, through its length, its breadth. I will give it to you. Before Kristen and I moved into our first house after we were married, I brought my bride over to the house to check it out. We brought out the tape measurer. We checked out the size of the rooms, seeing where we'd put all the furniture, deciding if there was enough room for the children. If not, they would camp out in the back. No, there was enough room for them. But we set it all up in our minds, and we would go over there several times before we moved in, because the more we looked at it, the more the anticipation grew, and that's what God's saying. Walk the land, Abraham. This is your land. Envision what you're going to do. As you read the book of Revelation, and you see all that God has in store for you, and you see in Romans chapter 8:17 that you're joint heirs with Christ, which means if Christ is your Savior today, everything he owns, you own. So spend some time every day thinking about what you're going to do with what you own. Because during the millennial kingdom, it's yours. You will rule with Christ in the earth. So let your imagination go wild. And if you would start thinking along those lines, it would erase some of the sadness, replace it with gladness and joy in your heart. Isn't that great? So he tells Abraham, walk the land, enjoy the land. Now, you know the truth. Abraham never owned the land in his lifetime. That thought hit me this past week when I was talking to the Lord about a dream that he's given me that's been going on for a long time, and he hasn't fulfilled it. I don't know if he ever will fulfill it. And God brought this thing to me about Abraham that maybe it's not in this life, Rick. Maybe. And some of the dreams and aspirations and ideas that you have for your life may not be realized until tomorrow. And that's okay, because this life is only the beginning of true life. So hang in there, child of God. Hang in there. Keep walking and trusting him. The blessing's going to come. Do you know Abraham was given that whole property by God, and when Sarai, his bride, died, he had to purchase a place to bury her in the land that he owned? That's all he knew his whole life. That his descendants started occupying the land, and they could have had the whole land. There would be no tension today over who owns the land had Israel walked with God like they should have walked with God and responded to the Messiah. There would be no Arabian people over there right now. They would own the land, they would have had the land, but they lost the land in 70 AD between April and the summer when Titus came in and wiped that out, and it went to nothing until we gave them the land in the 1940s. And ever since, there's been tension because they didn't do what God called them to from the beginning. Amen. They made poor decisions, particularly when it came to rejecting the Messiah and his death on the cross for them. That changed everything for the past 2,000 years. Be careful of the decisions that you make. They almost had the land in the book of Joshua, but in the book of Judges, they gave up the land through sin and degradation and connection with the Canaanites. But I'll tell you something. God keeps his promises. And if God's put a promise in your heart, at some point in time and eternity, he will keep that promise. And when God made the promise to Abraham of the covenant, he's going to keep it. And one day, Jesus is coming back. And Jesus is going to rule and reign from Jerusalem. And when Abraham comes back to that property, he can do anything he wants with it. Because it's not your land or my land, it's his land. God gave it to him. And he's going to be dancing the Irish jig when he comes back. He's going to love it. Well, that's his land. But to get the land, you have to have the lineage. And so we see his lineage. Verse 16, now go back to that. I will make your descendants, as the dust of the earth. If anyone can number the dust of the earth, your descendants can be numbered. Obviously a hyperbolic statement, not far from reality. If people could put in their heads all the Arabian people, all the Jewish people, all the Christian people, all those who've come from the loins of Abraham over the years, wow, that's a whole lot of people. And it's amazing. God said, and this is where faith comes in. We forget this. We read these statements. We see what God says, and we forget how old Abraham is. He's 75. He does not have a son. He has no offspring. And God said, you old codger, do you know that you're going to have children like the dust of the earth? And we're going to see in chapter 17 that Abraham said, you know something? I believe it. And God said, good, now you're righteous. And that's all it takes for you to be righteous today. To believe that Jesus Christ died for your sins and rose again. If you believe it, everything will change throughout all eternity. That's the step. That's the step that Abraham took. He believed God. He listened to God. And look at his response when God made that statement. Watch verse 18. Abraham moved his tent and came and dwelt by the oaks of Mamre. And in Hebrew, what did he do? He built another altar. Everywhere he goes, he builds a sanctuary for God. This is his expression of praise for God's goodness to him. I love this man, Abraham. And that brings us to the lingering lesson, and it's a great one. Don't miss it. Here it is. When I bless thee, God will bless me. Turn to the person next to you today and make that statement. When I bless thee, God will bless me. There's your principle for life. This principle was certainly true for Abraham, and it was certainly true today for a woman named Linda Wilson Allen. Linda Wilson Allen had her face and her story put on the front page of the San Francisco Chronicle. She is a metro transit operator. She loves the people who ride her bus, and she knows all their names. And if anyone is late for the bus stop, she waits for them and makes up the time later on the route. Woman in her 80s named Ivy had some heavy groceries, was struggling with them. She got out of her bus driver's seat. She walked down. She picked up the groceries and got Ivy seated. Now Ivy stands and waits for long times and will not ride any bus except the bus that Linda Wilson Allen drives. Linda saw a woman named Tanya in a bus shelter. She could tell her that Tanya was new to the area and she was lost. And it was Thanksgiving time. So she said, Tanya, honey, you're all out there by yourself. You don't know anybody. You come to our house for Thanksgiving and kick it with our family. And ever since, they've been great friends. The reporter who wrote the article rides Linda's bus every day. And he said that Linda has built a community of fellowship in that bus. The passengers now are beginning to offer her use of their vacation homes because they love her so much. They bring her potted flowers and floral bouquets. They discovered she likes to accessorize her uniforms with scarves, so now they're just flooding her with scarves. One person, upgraded it to a rabbit fur collar. The article says that Linda may be the most beloved bus driver since Ralph Cramden and the Honeymooners. Remember him? Some of you know who I'm talking about. Now, you think about driving a bus. You think about a thankless job. Cranky passengers, constant traffic, gum stuck on the seats. You ask yourself, hey, how can Linda have that attitude? Here's how. Her mood is set at 2:30 every morning. She gets out of her bed, onto her knees, and spends 30 minutes praying for her route. What would life be like if you got out of your bed every day and prayed for an opportunity to be a blessing over the next sunlit hours? Oh. Linda said there's a whole lot to talk about to the Lord Jesus during that time. She's a member of the Glad Tidings Church in Hayward. When she gets to the end of the line, she always says, that's all. I love you all. Take care. A pastor I know of a large congregation invited Linda to speak at his church. He said, in the Silicon Valley, we deal with a lot of wealthy, upgraded people. These wealthy people were inspired to several standing ovations to give to a woman who drives a bus. They stood in line by the dozens afterwards to talk with her. Because the bus of number 45 opens to the kingdom of God. She chooses to be a blessing. And she receives a blessing. Let's quietly bow our heads. Is it about time that you choose, like Abraham and Linda, to be a blessing to someone? No, no, to everyone? I'll let you in on a secret this morning with your head bowed and eyes closed. I could tell you why the Catholics are nuts over the Pope. Because the Pope gives the blessing. Why don't you steal that? Why don't you be a little Pope? Why don't you go around and bless everyone you come in contact with? If you could alter your life just a few degrees and begin to be a blessing, you will see that God will bless you. Jesus did that. He gave up everything to receive the blessing of knowing you and me. And so the question of the hour is, does he have the blessing of knowing you personally and intimately today? Right there you're seated, and you're not sure about that. But I could tell you how you could enter into a life-changing relationship like Abraham and Linda have with the God of the universe today. All you need to do is recognize, like they have, that you've made mistakes, you're imperfect, and you're incapable of reaching God on the basis of your own efforts. But God loved you so much, the Bible says, that he wanted to be a blessing. So he sent his son, born at this time that we celebrate, to die for you. And if you would give your life to him today, he'll change everything. And you could have that city whose architect and builder is God in your portfolio for the future. You're saying, that's what I want, Pastor. Today, I want to pray to give my life to Christ. While every head is bowed, eyes are closed, God's speaking to you about that decision. You look at me right now between the eyes, and we will pray together, and you can enter into his family by faith. If that's your design, you can look at me right now. We thank you, Father, that by faith we have been accepted and loved by the Christmas child, by the one who came not to receive a blessing, but to be one. You told us when you spoke in Mark's Gospel, chapter 10, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. And you've given your life a ransom for those of us here today. You have set the pace. You have set the pattern. Now it's our opportunity this Christmas season to go out and to be a Pope and to be a blessing to every person we contact today. This is our prayer. Change us to bless others. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a couple quick announcements. The ladies get together for the food time. The bake sale is being canceled. It's supposed to be next week. They'll let you know in the future when it's going to happen. What's happening next Sunday night? Don't miss it. The Children's Christmas Parade. Dude, you hear what I hear? That's the title of it. It's going to be great. Right here at 5 p.m. Don't miss it. Whatever you have on your schedule, put it out and come here. Every year, the Zamoras put on a fantastic job, and it'll be like this year. So we're looking forward to 5 p.m. And then on Christmas Eve, we have our Christmas Eve service. So we hope you'll be here. It's a candlelight service at 6 p.m. Let's stand together, shall we, today? Is I don't know God's call for your life. Your spouse may not even know it, but you do. When you step out, it will be filled with fun, and I guarantee it will be checkered with failure. Both will come. But forgiveness will always be offered, provided you forge ahead by faith. First step on the faith-filled journey is to personally know the one who makes the journey possible. Jesus. The one we celebrated in communion this morning. The one who paid the ultimate price for your imperfections on a place called Golgotha. Right there in your heart, you could ask him to be the savior of your life by praying this prayer. Father, like Abraham, I make many mistakes and I need to be forgiven. And I want to know you personally today. Please forgive my failures. I accept Jesus as the Savior of my soul. I will love him and seek to live for him forever. If you prayed that prayer today in your heart, before you leave, just let me know the decision that you made for Christ. We're getting ready, Father, in a matter of weeks to step into 2016. And perhaps you're using a message like this to prep us for a new step of faith. Where do you want us to go? Who do you want us to invite to Orange Coast? Whose lives could be changed this year because of your life and us? What new ministries can begin? What old broken relationships that are ruptured can be restored? The sky's the limit. If we will follow your lead, would you say, ready or not, jump. Let us be ready. We pray in Jesus' name. Don't forget there's a card for each missionary today, and you could sign up in the foyer, and so the missionaries could get your John Hancock, and they'll be happy to see that on the mission field, the place where they're at. And remember, tonight, Martha and I are going to be teaching on the biblical and practical insights to essential oils. I think you'll be interested in all the Bible has to say on oil. Be sure to sign up. For the potluck, based on your name, it tells you what type of element you should bring. Main dish, drink, salad, or desserts. You'll find that in the foyer. We'll be meeting at 5 o'clock for dinner. And at 6 o'clock, we'll receive the insightful lessons from 5 to about 7. So let's stand together today. They're hoping, trusting, praying, crossing their fingers, and corroding their stomachs with acid, thinking, when I die, I hope my good enough deeds outweigh the bad ones, but I'll never know for sure. God said, you can know for sure today. You can know that I sent my son to die for all your failures, all your imperfections. He was placed on that cross so that you could be freed from anxiety forever. You could be freed of the worry of wondering, will I go to heaven when I die? You could know with absolute certainty that God has taken care of it for you. But you must place the rubber band, as it were, on your wrist, which means that right now you have to make a decision to release your present and future into his capable, caring hands. Will you do that this morning? Maybe you've never come to that place in life where you have acknowledged your need for a Savior. And today is going to be the change for your life. Today you're going to release everything to the Lord Jesus Christ for the very first time. You're saying, I want to become a Christian this morning. Pastor, pray for me that I will make that decision. That's your heart's desire. Take that right hand, raise it good and high, and I will pray for you right now. According to the testimony of the bowed heads, everyone in this room has made a decision for you. But my guess is the vast majority of us today have not made a decision yet to become positive. Father, don't let us leave until we center this subject deep in our souls this morning. Until we say, we're tired of the negative. I'm sick of being a pessimistic person. I will own the fact that my trouble and my anxiety is not because of what my parents did to me or what my boss is doing to me or my ex-spouse has done to me. I need to get off that merry-go-round and own it myself and realize no one could change my life but me. And Father, I want to yield to you today. I want you to make me into the positive, upbeat, worry-free person that you are. I want to give your grace and your peace to others. And like Danuma, I want to remember that everything works out fine when I place it in the capable hands of my loving Lord. That's my prayer for myself and for everyone in this church today. Now help us to wear the rubber band and to live the life of joy. We pray it in Jesus' name, and God's people said, Amen. Amen.